Over the last year, large language models, parameters, fine-tuning, grounding, all these terms have come into everyday parlance. But do we really understand them? I want to check how I'm doing. And to do that, I'm delighted that we've got Kareem Ayoub, who is a technology strategist from Google DeepMind, who are building and at the forefront of large language models and their use. So Kareem, let's take a step back and help us understand, like, when we're talking about building a large language model, what on earth does that mean?
Certainly. And large language models, or LLMs, are very complex AI systems. So we should take it step by step.
Right.
And we can liken it to how we might build a house.
Well, that sounds like something I can relate to. So take us through. So where do we start?
So we start with these amazing research innovations from across Google DeepMind, the broader Google, and also the broader industry, and really bring that together into a vision for the kind of LLM that we want to build. Maybe we determine the size of the LLM or the capabilities that the LLM will have.
So the research you're talking about is sort of computer science research that leads to these breakthroughs like transformers models and how we understand language as I read about it.
Exactly. And we bring all of that together to really set the fundamental architecture of that LLM. And in a similar way, when designing a house, we might start by asking ourselves, what kind of house do we want? Do we want it to be a cozy cottage or a sprawling mansion or maybe a modern apartment?
So it's almost like an architect's brief. We haven't got the detail. We've got a vision of like a Frank Lloyd Wright mountainside, beautiful property overlooking a lake, and that's where you're starting.
Exactly. Okay. And the next step in building an LLM is to set the initial parameters of the LLM.
The initial parameters, what do you mean?
So you can think of parameters as the numbers that define the inner workings of that model. Okay. It could be how the model interacts with itself and how information passes throughout that model in order to elicit those amazing capabilities that we see down the line.
So the parameters are a bit like the sort of blueprint of a house?
Spot on. So at this point, we've determined that maybe we want this kind of cozy cottage. Right. We then draw up the blueprints, which will determine the positioning of the windows and the doors, the thickness of the walls, and the layout of the various floors.
Okay, so it's a high-level schematic of what the model is going to be like.
Exactly. The next step in building an LLM is, you know, we've determined the kind of LLM we want to build. We've determined the initial parameters. We now need to go and gather the raw data to train the LLM. And the data is really important because the LLM will then read through that data, which could come from the internet, code, or other sources. It'll read through that data in much the same way that a human would in order to gain knowledge.
Right. When you're talking about this sort of getting the data, training the model, large really matters, doesn't it? We talk about lots and lots of parameters. So what's the scale of these things?
Exactly. So we're talking about trillions of different kind of pages and words and lines of code and things like that all coming together for the LLM to actually read through and develop that knowledge. And the quality and the kind of the data become really important. Mm-hmm. So if we train the LLM on only scientific literature, it might be challenging to ask that LLM to become really good at creative fiction.
Right. And here we're talking about sort of reading very broadly rather than, as I understand it, rather than learning facts, we are understanding the relationships between words. So these words tend to occur in relation to each other when we're talking about this scientific thing, or these words in relation to each other when we're talking about this poetry. Is that how I should think about it?
Exactly. So at this training stage, you can kind of think of it as the LLM going through its general education. For building our house at this stage, we want to collect the raw materials that we're going to eventually use that to comprise the house itself.
And these raw materials, in the case of something like Gemini, include words and images and video and coding and different languages, right?
Exactly. And all of that comes together for the LLM to read and understand and learn from those various data sources.
Okay, so we're going out and getting a wide array of the best raw materials that can help us to build our house, to build our large language model.
Exactly. So the next step is to actually fuel the LLM to read through all of that material. It requires a lot of computers, and we use those large amounts of computers in order for the LLM to actually process all of that information. The more computers we have, the faster and more efficiently the LLM can actually read through all that material and gain that knowledge.
And it feels like there's a global race right now. You read about NVIDIA and chips and data centers. So everybody's trying to build these very, very large language models, which need a lot of computing power, compute you call it, in order to kind of go out and read and understand all of that data. Is that what's happening?
Exactly. A lot of these LLMs require a huge amount of compute in order for them to actually process all of those different pieces of information. And in the same way, when building a house, we actually need to hire the construction crew to take those raw materials and fashion them into the bricks, the concrete, and the glass that will comprise the house itself.
So it's a bit like there's a run on house building, and if you're a building contractor, it's a good time to be in that industry.
Certainly.
Right, okay. So we're training our model, using compute and using lots of data. How do we then make the model useful?
So at this stage, we have a generally knowledgeable model. We call it the base model of the LLM. It's kind of, you can think of it as a jack of all trades, but not necessarily a jack of the trades that we care about.
Master of none.
A master of none.
Okay.
So at this point, we need to specialize the model, the Gemini model, to become really good at the things that we care about Gemini being very good at. Mm-hmm. So we take special data, additional data, and have the model learn on that subset of data to become really good at the myriad of tasks, for example, that go into the Gemini app or AI overviews or AI studio.
Right, and Gemini is Google's series of large language models, isn't it? And we mostly see it through something like the Gemini app where it's multi-purpose. So you're saying you're sort of fine-tuning it on lots of different things which you think a typical user might want Gemini to be able to do. Is that right?
Exactly. So if we want that model to become really good at coding, for example, we might feed in specialized coding data for the model to really pore over and become a great coder.
So this is fine-tuning?
This is fine-tuning. So in the same way for our house, we now are left with kind of the shell of a completed house with all the rooms and all the floors complete. We now need to furnish the house, and that's exactly what fine-tuning is.
Okay. So it's saying this room is going to be a library. We need books, or it's going to be a library for medical purposes. Let's get medical books on the shelves, that kind of thing.
Exactly. Or picking that perfect couch for the living room for you to sit on.
Now, I've read that there's different types of fine-tuning that you can do, and some of it involves human intervention or kind of giving the model feedback. Tell us a bit more about that.
Exactly. So we can also do reinforcement learning on the model.
Reinforcement learning.
Exactly. Okay. So reinforcement learning kind of works like this. Maybe we want the model to get really good at summarization. We might then have the model write lots of summaries, and then we will go and tell the model, I like this summary, I don't like that summary. Right. And if we do that multiple times, many times over, the model will get really good at understanding Matt likes this kind of a summary.
Right. So that would be human inputs to the model training at that point.
Exactly. And that's important because it aligns the model to our human preferences. Right. And that alignment is important when we're building products because we ultimately want the model to also embody the product experience that we're trying to build.
Right. So you can fine-tune a model for general purposes, but I also read, you know, people want to put models to work for things like helping with medical diagnoses or helping lawyers understand multiple different statutes and laws in order to kind of come up with recommendations. So is it possible for a model to get really good at a couple of different uses like that? And how would you do that?
Exactly. So, you know, if you're a law firm looking to use our Gemini model, you know, the general chatbot may not necessarily suit your purposes for your law firm. So you might work with Google Cloud to further fine-tune that model on specific data that maybe your law firm cares about, such that the model can get really good at the tasks you want it to be good at.
Right, so then if I was a law firm, I would want to use all of Gemini and the great work that you've done and my data, but I want to keep it to myself. So would that also be training Google or whoever else I'm working with? Would it be training their model, or do I keep control?
The company in this case would get to keep control. Okay. And it's up to Google to make sure that that data is stored securely, that any fine-tuning that happens is for the access of that law firm. So in the case of our house, we've picked out the perfect couch for that law firm, and no one else is allowed to sit on
it. Okay. So that's one use which is getting very specialized and accurate. I guess another kind of use of these large language models is to get really creative. So it helps understand how you get that distinction between sort of accurate but boring, like you would want from a doctor, and sort of less worried about accurately but much more creative, like you might want from somebody in the creative industries or advertising.
So on the one hand, as you said, we have law firms and other use cases which require that total factuality. On the other hand, we have use cases which require that creative partner or companion for you to be able to brainstorm and generate different kinds of texts and summaries and things like that. In that case, again, we might fine-tune on specific kinds of texts that mirror the kind of creativity that we want, or the specific tastes that we have through reinforcement learning, that human feedback for the model.
Yeah, because some of the things I've enjoyed using Gemini to do are like write poetry or come up with some suggested cartoons or visuals, which it's really creative in doing, but I don't necessarily want that creativity in my search results.
Exactly. So specializing the model for these different use cases, whether it's a creative companion or a very factual source for you to be able to rely on, is really important to get right so that you can fine-tune the model for your purposes.
And can you tell us a little bit more about safety? Just in a housing analogy, obviously I want the house to be safe, not fall down, be fireproof as much as it can be, and so on and so forth. How do you think about safety and your responsibility when you are designing and building and making available to the rest of us the Gemini model series?
Safety is critical to integrate throughout every single step of the LLM process that we just talked about. So when selecting the data that ultimately the LLM will learn from, we want to make sure that it's data that we want the LLM to actually learn from and not data that, for example, could be harmful.
So good data builds good AI.
Good data builds good AI.
So yeah, when you're designing, building, and making these models available to people, you've obviously got to think hard about safety. Give us a couple of examples of how you do that.
Absolutely. Safety is critical in every step of building an LLM that we just talked about. From the data that we choose, we want to make sure that the data going into the LLM is indeed the data that we want the LLM to learn from and is not harmful in some way. So good data in this case builds good AI. Mm-hmm. We also want to make sure that we're giving feedback in that reinforcement learning step to make sure that the model responds in the way that we want it to, such that when the model is maybe asked a harmful question, the model is resilient to those kinds of questions.
And that's obviously a learning journey. And I noticed that, you know, you asked for feedback in the Gemini app on whether something was good or bad, or whether there's any other feedback. I guess that human input's really important here.
Exactly. Whether it's giving a thumbs up or a thumbs down or helping rewrite the response a little bit, all of that feedback is really useful in building the ultimate experience that we want our users and customers to have.
Kareem, you've helped us better understand the sort of whole process of the vision of a model, how it gets constructed, how it gets kind of used or furnished in your terms so that individual uses can really work, and how you try to think about keeping it safe. Take us through some of the capabilities of these large language models that you're excited about. They might be here today. They might be things you're working on.
Sure. The first capability I'm really interested in is something called long context.
Long context. Tell me more.
So when you provide, you know, that text prompt to the model, how much text you can provide is the context for that model. It's working memory.
Right. So mostly that's short prompts, a few lines that I write into the Gemini app or into another chatbot.
Exactly. So a model with shorter context might only be able to have one paragraph of input before it can summarize it and run out of memory. A model with longer context could maybe take several pages or hundreds of pages, and then you can ask it to summarize that.
And what's possible in Gemini today then?
Today in Gemini, you can input 2 hours of video or 24 hours of audio or 10 full novels for Gemini to actually process.
So then I could say, right, read all these books and tell me the plot lines, or help me understand this scientific research and write it in a way that a 12-year-old could understand, that kind of thing.
Exactly, or help you to brainstorm even new ideas together.
So, wow, long context sounds really useful. What are the other capabilities you're really excited about?
So I'm also very excited about multimodality, or having the models think in the same way that you and I do. Meaning the models can read, the models can write, the models can see, and the models can hear.
Okay.
So what this means is that we want the models to become more proficient at all of those different inputs to the model, and also that the same outputs as well.
So this is like where I can sort of upload a picture and say, kind of tell me about this and do such and such. It's two different types of input, or multiple different types of input.
Exactly. Or maybe you have a question about a video or a piece of audio, and you want to, again, use that model as a collaborative partner through the process of understanding that information.
Brilliant. Now I understand multimodality. What else is out there? What else is coming?
So the third thing that we're really interested in is agents. So taking the base models that we've just built and moving them from today, what is kind of an input-output relationship. You ask a question, you get an answer, to really how can the model do more for you? How can it assist you in additional tasks? Maybe the model will take more time to do deeper research, for example, on a very complex topic, or maybe the model will help take actions, for example, booking that flight for you.
So today feels like you're working a little bit tag team with a model. You're sort of saying, give me five ideas for what I might do over the weekend in Paris, and then book this one.
Exactly. Or if you have a really hard research topic, maybe having the model spend a little bit more time with itself to really process that information in a more nuanced way and give you a better response at the end of it.
Wow, that's amazing. And if people want to learn even more, what would you recommend they do?
My recommendation is really to go out there and try it. There are a lot of different models out there available. You can go try it on Gemini app. You can go to AI Studio. You can test it in the AI overviews and your Google search results. Testing it is really important to really get a sense for what these models are capable of.
Great. Kareem, thank you. Everybody, let's go out and play.